Good evening, one and all. Today, we are present here for an Ask Me Anything session on the FinTech and Financial Blockchain program with IIM Calcutta and Talent Sprint. So we have Harish with us, who is our alum from cohort one. Harish is also a director with Fiserv. And you guys may all have your questions ready, or you may also post it on the chats for us to take it up in the end. An introduction on myself, I am Sharda Iyer, and I have been a part of Talent Sprint ever since 2019. I'm a counselor for the FinTech and the Financial Blockchain program with IIM Calcutta ever since the start of the program, wherein the cohort started back in 2019 May. So over these two and a half years, I have counseled hundreds of candidates, and then I have given them insights on the course, benefits of taking up this course at their juncture in their career. So we'll start quickly with an introduction of Harish. Harish, you may please take over.
Sure, thank you, Sharda. So good evening all. My name is Harish Karunakaran. I work for a company by name Fiserv. I've been in the financial technology space for almost 20 years plus now. And as Sharda mentioned, I was, you know, one of those, I was part of the first cohort of this course. So you know, all of us who joined that took a chance, right? We didn't know what we are entering into. And yeah, I should say, you know, obviously it has been a great experience, and that's why I was happy to be part of this evening session when, you know, the Talent Sprint team reached out to me saying, okay, more than happy to, you know, connect and share the experience with the next cohort and all of you who are interested in pursuing this course. So happy to address any queries that you have today.
Right. Thank you so much for a wonderful kickstart, Harish. So Harish, if you can just quickly throw some light on what exactly as a part of your career that you're doing. And since you work out of a fintech domain in there, what are the trends which you are currently seeing in the fintech space, specifically in India? I mean, I know there's so much of buzz around on the rec tech, insurtech, wealth tech, right? So if you can quickly throw some light on that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, it's a very, very, you know, there's no two ways about it, right? Right from the IPOs which are out there, which are from fintech companies, you know, or companies which are tech companies with a, you know, obviously a payments or a, you know, financial angle attached to it, right? So every company out there today, which is a startup, or every company which is a large enterprise today, has something or the other to do with fintech, right? So there's no escape from that. you know, I mean, there's no business out there which cannot do away without payments, which cannot do away without financing, which cannot do away without insurance, right? So these are three building blocks of finance, which are now embedded into, you know, every institution through, I would say, fintech, right? So that's at a very high level, if I may put it that way. So the opportunity is immense. If you look at the kind of job roles which are getting advertised in the market today, you get to see fintech roles coming from companies which you don't connect to them as fintech directly, but they're all wanting to be part of the, you know, fintech revolution which is happening in the market, right? If you're sitting with data today, you know, that is, you know, data is oil. It's not something which, you know, we can ignore. And that same data is what drives fintech eventually, right? So if you have data, you can utilize the data to, you know, kind of understand the context behind every transaction that is happening. When I say transaction, I'm not talking about payment transaction. I'm talking about buying and a selling which is happening. And hence, you can actually, you know, enrich that data to offer a lot of financial products using the technology behind it. So I think that's where the world is moving in terms of, you know, contextually offering fintech at the point where the customer is interacting with you as a business, right? So it's immense. The potential is immense. The word digital is right across every industry, and hence fintech is right across every industry. That's the way I see it.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much. How has the market changed now? Of course, I mean, 2 years down the line, we've had the pandemic situation in picture. How has the market changed, or maybe how has the market adopted the fintech space in here, both from the business side and, of course, the consumer side in here?
Yeah, I mean, while the pandemic is an unfortunate event in our lifetime, but I think for payments, for fintech, right, I think it has been, and for digitalization on an overall basis, right, it has been one of the biggest boosters, right? So anybody who's not having a digitalized business today, whatever segment you are in, you are out of the race, because you just cannot, you know, be in touch with your partners, whether it is consumer or whether it is business, if you don't have a way to digitally interact with them, digitally take your business forward, right? So it has been, you know, while the consumer, if I talk specifically from a Fiserv perspective and, you know, the business that we are in, where we acquire, you know, transactions at the merchant side. Obviously, the volume of transactions went down. Lockdowns were counterintuitive for sure because businesses were not open. People were lesser revenues to spend. So obviously, from that perspective, the volume of business probably has come down during this period. But the amount of digitalization, the amount of adoption of contactless ways of doing business, contactless ways of doing transactions have just gone up, right? So businesses which had no way of doing something paperless has gone paperless suddenly, right? So all those are getting ourselves prepared for as the businesses open up, as the world opens up, as the travel opens up. I think we are going to see a tremendous increase in business volumes through these digitalized processes which have been established during this lean period, right? So every business has adopted. Those who have not adopted, I'm sure, don't exist anymore, or they won't exist in the time to come. So I think you know, while pandemic by itself has been a big disaster, and hopefully we'll all come out of it victoriously soon, I think it has been a big boost for digitalization, fintech, and adoption of, you know, I would say payments, going through digitalized banking for sure. So I think overall, right, I mean, it has been a big boost. Even look at investments, you know, I think the traditional investments have gone away. Today, people are happy to go and even look at cryptocurrencies without probably really understanding what is the risk behind it, what are we investing. But people are willing to experiment, right? Because the traditional business of, can I invest into a commercial establishment? Can I invest into my third house? I think that thought process has started changing, right? People are willing to experiment. People are looking at new financial products. And all of them are purely, you know, if I would say 100% digital products, right? So it's interesting. The world is changing, definitely.
Of course. So with that, next is a question which I would probably want to put on the program that we particularly have in here. So this is a combination of fintech with blockchain. So do you think it's a right way to probably put fintech and blockchain together under one heading? And if the answer is yes, you may also comment on how the blockchain technology is kind of transforming the financial services in here.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when I enrolled for this course, right, I should be honest, right? I think I did not, when I looked around, I at that point of time, at least today, I do see a lot of, you know, courses which have this kind of a combination. But I think it was very innovative for IIM and, you know, Talent Sprint to come together with this combination, right? And as somebody who has been in the fintech world for almost 20 years, I think for me, blockchain was still a kind of unknown, right, in terms of what was the intricacies behind it, what is the potential behind it, where is the world headed in terms of blockchain, et cetera, right? So I was quite curious to understand about blockchain, and that was the reason one of the reasons why I definitely enrolled for this course when I decided to do that, right, 2 years ago. So is it a good combination? I think so, because, you know, these are two ends of the spectrum, if I may put it that way, right? Fintech is happening today. Blockchain probably will become the happening thing in the years to come, right? So you're just being prepared, right? You are just being prepared to be in the midst of what is happening today around you and be prepared for that. And with the eyesight into the future in terms of, okay, if somebody is coming and talking to you about, let's keep, you know, Bitcoins away and keep the cryptocurrencies away, right? That's given. People have different understanding. People have not jumped into it. I don't want to get into it, right? Personally, I have not invested, right? Because probably with the understanding that I have from this course and with the understanding of blockchain, I personally don't believe cryptocurrency is where I'll put my hard-earned money, right? But tomorrow, if a central bank digital currency is the way to go, which I firmly believe is where the world will move towards, right? And if it is going to be built on blockchain technology, I think I have a fairly good understanding of talking about it, seeing where the use cases will adapt. And then eventually, right? I mean, do I trust that technology? Do I trust something which is built on blockchain? The answer to it, because of what I learned in the course and whatever I had, you know, learned over a period of time after that, I would say yes. I think it's important to have that understanding. It is important to, you know, keep learning about it and be ready as and when the world has actually truly adapted blockchain in its commercial sense. I don't think it has yet done that, but it will over a period of time, right? I think that's the direction the world is moving towards. So it's more of being prepared for the future than, you know, for what is happening today. That's the way I look at blockchain.
Right. So what made you choose this program? I mean, particularly since this was also, a combination of fintech and blockchain. And I kind of myself remember when, we kind of started back in 2019 with IIM Calcutta and Talent Sprint together on this program. Why fintech was a part of your thought process at that point of time?
Okay. I mean, in my case, I think, it was more about, it was a course being offered through IIM. So, aspirationally, having an IIM tag attached was always meaningful, I thought, right? And that's one. Mm-hmm. Second, there were not too many courses at that point of time which had this combination of fintech and blockchain and giving you a, for example, while I claim myself to be a fintech professional, my focus within fintech, there are a lot of domains within fintech, right? I have been more focused on payments and, that has been my specialization, right? So getting a slightly wider spectrum into insurance, into the capital markets, right? I think when I saw all those were being covered in this course, I thought it made a larger sense. Again, data analytics, the ability to be part of a cohort and doing some projects together. I thought those are the kind of courses that we should be part of, right? It is not about just, just listening to professors talking to you and you kind of, in the typical traditional way, learning what they're teaching you. I don't think that was the intent behind this course. And thankfully it didn't go that way, right? What I really cherish about this course after I participated is that experience that you gain out of interacting with your cohort, obviously reflecting from your experiences and then learning together, right? So all those were wonderful. Some of the expectations that I met, but I mean, going back to your question, yes, I think it was all about probably attaching a tag, from an IIMC, which was the biggest mover for me at that point of time. For 20 years of experience, if I had an IIM tag added to what I have already gone through and, getting it polished, I would say, right? And have a, institution like IIM certifying that he or she is somebody, who has gone through a professional certification around it, I thought it would add a lot of value. And I should say, yes, within my circle, professional circle, I think I get looked upon for whatever tag this, it brings along with.
How do you think, Harish, the traditional banks have opened up to the fintech space? I'm sure there would be a lot of challenges too. So if you may throw some light on that.
In fact, it'll be interesting to note that, some of the small banks, I would not call them traditional. They are the old small private sector banks, right? They are in India context, right? They are probably the leaders to adopt fintech because they suddenly saw this as an opportunity to be in the market fast because they are nimble. They can adapt, take decisions faster. It's all about decision making too, right? You get to hear a beautiful use case from a fintech. How do you kind of make a decision to move forward with them, right? And have the right risk management framework behind to ensure that this program doesn't, cross the lines that it is supposed to cross. Because you are eventually responsible to answer with the regulator. So as long as, in India, most of the large banks probably are trying to do fintech themselves. And the small traditional banks have actually gone ahead and created programs with the fintechs, right? So they are actually fast, nimble, have created more programs in the market. Whereas the traditional banks are trying to adapt and become a fintech themselves. Obviously, some of them have tried to use fintech companies to build solutions for them. That's the way they have gone. But going into the market together, I think it is the traditional smaller banks who have done better, if you ask, in terms of creating new programs in the market.
Right. So, Harish, you were the part of the first cohort. What do you think are the major key takeaways of the program for you? And also, how did you implement the learning of the program in your day-to-day business as such?
Yeah, I think, let me address the first question, which I partially answered in the last, last session. So, I think, every time I get this question, whether it is from, people who want to join this course or, let's say from you, Shraddha, I think first thing that comes in my mind is that, the joint learning, right? And especially the way the program is structured to make you do projects for every subject that you're going through, right? I think those projects, doing it as part of a cohort and the learning that you get from the combined experience from the team which is doing this course together, right? Because everybody comes with diverse work experience and they have their own learnings that they have had through their career. That all comes out while you reflect to in that project, right? So there's no better learning than that. And obviously kudos to professors, while some of them are very good in terms of their academic knowledge. And, you know, it is more about the academic vigor they bring in. There are a few others who actually mix the industry knowledge along with the academic vigor they have. So, you know, depending on their style of teaching, I would say, you know, obviously you have to get the best out of all of them, right? How much you give into the course, they'll also give you that much more. So I think it is how much you get involved in the course, that much you more you get out of it, right? So that's one single message that I want to deliver to the, you know, team which is listening to our talk here, right? So don't shy away from getting involved, right? You may not know everything, that's okay. But give your best and learn from whatever you get from, you know, the cohort that you have. Obviously, the professors are SMEs in their respective areas. You know, assimilate as much as you can, right? Maybe we are all across that age where you can learn formulas. That's okay. But, you know, get as much as you can from that, right? Because ultimately, it is retesting your ability to learn at whatever age and, you know, experience that you carry today, right? With experience, with age, sometimes you tend to say, I cannot learn anymore. But I think courses like this will reassure you that, you know, learning is for your life, right? You will continue to learn. And believe me, I mean, I've been continue to read so much around this subject, even after the course, that, you know, I just have the confidence that, you know, I'll never stop learning. Let me put it there. And obviously, you'll apply that in your day-to-day life, in your work environment, any new subject that you get. So in my company, I get called upon for ideating, for sure, right? So that's something which is a big change for me. So I'm not restricted to a domain or a knowledge that I have. I have an open mind to actually learn and reflect back on that. I think maybe it was there with me. Probably this course helped me to refine it. Let me put it then.
Right. So I personally remember, Harish, that, you know, we had a very great start with regards to this program, since it was also a first cohort. We kind of started with 100 people in class.
That's
I'm sure you were associated with varieties of people in there, people probably from different streams of business, people from different backgrounds in there. So if you would be able to throw some light on your peer group, what kind of people did you associate with? And how, as a group of 100 people, how did it actually benefit you?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, I mean, the group was quite diverse, both in terms of the industries they came from, right? And, you know, we had people who were VC, you know, angel investors. We had people who were, you know, trying to look for a job change, people who wanted to get into fintech, people who have been, you know, like me, who have been in the fintech world for many years, people who are bankers who are trying to adapt to, you know, the new fintech world because they have been traditional bankers and being challenged by the, you know, word fintech itself. They wanted to move because they know there's no more banking without technology, and then they wanted to adapt to that. So I think it was a great mix, different, you know, levels of experience. People, I think we had cohort people coming in from Dubai, from Singapore, right? So even some international, you know, participants for sure. I think it was a good diverse group, right? And we are still in touch. That's the best part, right? The cohort of 100, I would say at least 30, 40 of us are quite actively in touch with each other. We do exchange our thoughts. We do bring opportunities to each other, whether it is in the form of business, job, whatever. So I think, you know, that, you know, like minds meeting together, hundreds of us together in one room. And obviously, thanks to the format at that point of time, I don't know, Sharda, whether, you know, today, you know, the new cohorts have the ability to be at the IMC campus. You know, if they have, I think that is one of those brilliant experiences that I still recall, right? Two times we could be in the campus, be together, you know, I mean, that definitely helps in the bonding, right? And good memories for sure, for a lifetime. Yeah.
So Harish, we get a lot of senior professionals asking if, you know, this is the right age for them to take up this program. We've majorly had people with 30 plus years of experience asking this question. And I've had a tough time convincing them because they usually feel that, you know, we are not too sure if, you know, this would be the right program, since, you know, it's going to be pretty much a mixed crowd in there. So we have people from various backgrounds. Now we have people from the traditional banking space. We have people from finance, we have people from technology background, and with the kind of experience that they anyway have, do you think it makes sense to probably have all of these different kind of people under one roof?
No, absolutely. I can reflect back to the cohort we were, right? We had people who had retired, right, in our cohort, right? Unfortunately, you know, who was about to retire, one of them actually lost their life. So, you know, very recently due to COVID. So, I mean, we had different age groups in the group. The way I see it is, you know, people who are, you know, 30 years of experience, they bring the, you know, huge amount of knowledge and experience from the, you you know, the non-fintech world typically, right? 30 years ago, there was no fintech to the extent, you know, what we talk about fintech today, right? And then you'll have in the same batch people who are probably 5 to 10 year experience who are very actively involved with fintechs today or want to do something on their own in the fintech world. So if with 30 years you are actually deciding to take up this course, I'm assuming it is not for another job. It is probably for, you know, investment purposes or for getting involved with fintechs as an advisory level, or maybe you want to start a fintech of your own. Probably you will find your, you know, batchmates, you will find your, not batchmates, I would say your co-founders here, right? You may want a technologist as part of your new journey, right? And you may find some of them because everybody who's coming here are passionate about fintech and that's why they're joining this course. So it's meeting of like-minded people together with a common interest of fintech there. So, you know, it's co-learning, right? You might have ideas to exchange with them. You might learn from the, both sides will learn, right? Person with a 10-year experience, I would never look upon him. Right? I would definitely look upon him to learn rather than kind of, you know, enforce my learning onto him, right? So I think age is in the mind. If you're here to take up this course, there is a purpose behind it. And I'm sure you'll find a reason why you'll find a benefit out of being this course, which is linked to your purpose, right? So it's all about defining why you are taking up this course with a 30 year of experience and then see how you can gain out of diverse people in this group, right?
Right. Harish, I mean, you know that, you know, you have done two projects while you were doing this program. There's a major capstone project that you had done towards the end of the cohort. So how do you think that was worked upon? You may please talk a little about that. I mean, how did you go about choosing a particular topic? Were there guidelines given by IIM Calcutta professors? And how did you as a group come up with a topic? And what kind of research was done behind the capstone project that you had proposed?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the guidelines came from the professors. And the time was short, I should be honest, maybe because it was the first cohort and, you know, we are trying to contain everything in that 6 months time frame, right? So by the time we got the guidelines and by the time we had to, I recall, it was kind of last minute for us, right? And when we were told, you guys go and figure out your project, right? That was like a challenge. Because where do you go and find that, you know, project which will meet all those guidelines and will still have the meat when we finally deliver the project, right? It shouldn't be meaningful for the, you know, institution as well as for all of us as a group, right? So thankfully, you know, most of us came from the industry, had the experience, had the connect. And luckily, in the group that I was in, there was somebody who was working for a microfinance company and they were doing something very interesting on the fraud management side. And, you know, we thought probably we should dig deep into that and propose that as the project with the professor. And professor liked it. They obviously, you know, professors had their views in terms of how to enrich it. And yeah, I would say, you know, given the time constraint we had, I would say we delivered a fairly decent project, right? If we had a little bit more time, I think, you know, at that point of time, we would have delivered a much better outcome. But yeah, maybe over a period of time with the next cohorts, I'm sure that would have got redefined and, you know, probably the outcomes were much better. But that's the recall that I have. I mean, it was interesting, valuable, you know, the ability to go and look for a project ourselves, that itself is a learning, right? If we are told, go and do this, that is different, right? Here we had to go and find a project, validate ourselves that it was worthwhile doing it. We can apply the learnings into it and come up with a good outcome, right? So that itself was a learning, I would say. And I think that should not change, right? Because everybody who's going to be part of this project, I don't think they are fresh out of college, ideally. Mm-hmm. Right. They are either in fintech or they are doing something with an aspiration to be in fintech. So between the cohort, you should be able to always find projects in the market yourself, right? Obviously, if IIM can help, that's fine for people who cannot get it. But I think, you know, that's part of the learning.
Of course. Harish, how does a fintech company, or I should probably put it this way, what should fintech companies particularly consider when they evolve their product or probably they kind of want to change their product?
Okay, I mean, that's a very broad question. So I'll have to really think about, you know, I mean, I think, you know, as long as you are actually solving for, I mean, it's a very, very simple thumb rule, right? If you're actually solving for a real problem statement out there and your persona against whom you're actually trying to solve for has actually validated that, yes, indeed, I have this problem and what you're trying to solve is actually solving the problem, right? then you should go ahead and build that product, right? Or you should go ahead and make that change. If you don't validate these two, right? Sometimes you believe, okay, this is a problem statement, but belief is one thing, but going and actually revalidating that, that's exactly the problem statement that the persona is, you know, the persona or the business is actually facing, right? There's no point building it, right, in the back end. So it's all about being very close to that persona or the business segment for which you are actually building a new fintech product or modifying your existing fintech product, unless you do that validation in person as a founder or as a person who is part of the product management team, right? You shouldn't go and make that change. So that's one thumb rule, right?
Right.
So it sounds simple, but many people don't do it, right? Because it's all assumptions based sometimes. And then you build the product and then take it to the market and realize, oh my God, you know, half of my assumptions don't hold true anymore. Because right, right. There's also a time to be in the market, right? Mm-hmm. By the time, you know, and you have to have that constant check. So that agile philosophy, again, very important, right? Okay. Bring products in 2 weeks if you can, right? And see if it works. Mm-hmm. It's okay. It may not be the, you know, end user worthwhile product. That's okay. But, you know, bring sprints into the market. See whether it is worthwhile, right? So those are important because fintech is all about being agile, being fast, being nimble, you know, being relevant at the end of the day. So by the time you bring it to the market, please keep checking the relevance of what you're doing, right?
Right. Well, I also have a question. I'm so sorry I missed it, kind of. This is probably a continuation of the previous question that I had asked you on the Capstone project. You may also pick up your answer from that. I'm sure you would have come across interesting fintech ideas or probably a lot of potential that was there in the fintech space particularly. So either while you were doing the fintech program with IIM Calcutta, or probably after that, now that's almost 2 years plus after you've done the program, I'm sure you would have come up with n number of interesting ideas in there. So would you be able to give us some insight on that?
Okay, I mean, it's a very broad topic and, you know, I mean, you know, let me talk about, you know, ideas which I come across in our own, in my own industry, right? I mean, I would probably go and write on some of the credit card use cases, right? I mean, if you really think about credit cards in the past, right, it was all about getting a physical card in your hand, right? And then, you know, that will take 7-8 days, 10 days after you apply in the bank, and then it will come to you via post, and then you start transacting, right? So today, you know, you will see in the market, there are, you know, fintechs out there. You can actually apply online and you will get your card instantaneously, right, onto your mobile phone. And then you can start transacting with that same card then and there itself, right? So that's a leapfrog in terms of how a financial product used to be get delivered in a physical form through a bank, which used to take 7 to 8 days, suddenly being changed to, you know, 3 to 4 minutes. And I can talk about number of clicks you do, right? Maybe you do 4 to 5 clicks. And that's it. You did your Aadhaar authentication. And it is not because a bank innovated, right? Or a fintech innovated. It is a whole country evolving, if you see, right? To innovate in the financial space, the infrastructure in the country had to also evolve. And thankfully, India has leapfrogged there, right? Whether you call it the presenceless layer, the contactless layer, Aadhaar layer, whatever, right? All those are available in this country, right? And that is only it's only growing. Tomorrow, you'll have account aggregators. You'll have something called open credit enabled network. In this country, all this is basically ensuring that, you know, you are able to do, what do you call, you know, flow-based financial services. That means there's a data flowing, and based on the data, a bank is able to intervene into the data and offer financial products at that point of time. So again, going back to this, right? Today, if there are transactions happening on Amazon, you know, banks are able to lend both to the merchant who is selling, as well as they're able to lend to the person who's buying, right? On that platform. It's amazing. Earlier, a lending would mean the seller would have to apply to a bank and then get a loan approved. Today, that's gone. The bank is saying, here is your loan. Do you want to take it? Because I see your data already. Mm-hmm. I know you've been on this platform for, you know, many years. I have your historic data and that's good enough for me to underwrite you, right? So it's proactive. It's at the point of sale. It is probably, you know, more of consent based rather than you applying. You just have to say yes, and the money is available, right? So, you know, most of the use cases are becoming embedded in that sense. You know, it's, you know, simple use cases, right? You are taking an Ola trip. And again, you know, these are things which we see in real life today. Suddenly, as part of the trip, you've got a micro insurance
sold to you. All you're saying is either you're saying yes to it or you're unticking a box saying, I don't want it. If you don't untick, you bought an insurance for that right. So it's already sold to you. It's financial, you know, product being sold to you as part of that Ola trip that you're booking, right? So similarly, there'll be more and more use cases, you know, which will get embedded into, you know, whether it is Zomato's of the world, you know, it's more about financial products getting embedded into the digitization of industries, right? So Ola is one example, right? Similarly, you will see this kind of use cases happening in, you know, pharmacies, right? In that part of the world, right? You've got this pharma apps out there. Again, financial products are being sold under that, right? So every industry, as it goes through its digitalization, will have fintech getting embedded under that, and hence banking products being made available as part of those flows which are not banking flows. That is your normal day-to-day, you know, business that you're going about, and financial products will start getting attached to that. That's how the world is evolving, right? So, and that's why fintech is taking so much of prominence. It's all about banks making their products available through open banking, APIs, etc., and embedding those flows into every industry's digitalization. I don't know whether I covered it at a broad umbrella level, but that's how the use cases are evolving.
Thank you so much. The other participants in the webinar, I would just request 5 more minutes for Mr. Harish. I have two to three more questions to shoot, and then I would probably pick up questions from the chat which you've posted in there.
Sure.
The others can also continue posting questions. I would quickly take it up the moment I finish it. So the next question for you, Harish, would be, when you look at people in this space, what are the qualities particularly you look at before hiring them?
I think point one is, you know, willingness to learn and unlearn. Mm-hmm. The industry is so fast moving that, you know, if you continue to believe that you know everything, then you're outdated, right? So I would consider myself a student every day I start my day, right? I would want to, you know, keep an open mind, listen, understand, relearn if required. And because, you know, it is very fascinating to me, right? Because what I knew 10 years ago and what I knew 20 years ago, in principle, may be still relevant, but not in the context of technology anymore, right? So it's very important that whomever I hire, I first check his ability to learn, his ability to keep up to date, you know, in terms of how technology is changing, right? His ability to understand the process, because, you know, businesses that you would encounter every day could be very different. If you are not somebody who can map the process behind that business, there's no way you're going to digitize that business. And if you cannot digitize that business, or you cannot think about digitizing that business, there's no way you're going to apply fintech on it, right? So that's the way I look at it. And this is one criteria I would definitely look at in terms of, you know, anybody whom I will hire, right? His ability to look at business processes and, you know, ability to digitize those. And obviously, when you do that, you're obviously learning about a new business. You cannot do it without, you know, mapping that business end to end. So that's
right,
one.
What are the major takeaways as a student from this program, Harish? I mean, what kind of skills or knowledge as a student would one develop at the end of the program? Is it only in the line of fintech, or probably they can also, you know, imbibe the given knowledge and implement something in their line of business, maybe consulting or any other stream of business?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. I think, you know, no learning, you know, any learning can be applied across the different interests that every individual has, right? Mm-hmm. So in my current capacity as an employee, I apply, you know, the learning in whatever I could do within the company, right? But at the same time, I do, you know, help out fintechs in my personal capacity, right? So the learning that I apply there is very different, with a different context in mind, right? So yes, you know, indeed, it can help both in your, irrespective of whether you're working for a fintech company or a company which would eventually interact with a fintech to deliver something in the market, right? Or it could be just pure play, you are interacting with banks. Banks are today fintechs in a way, right? I mean, they are no longer the traditional banks, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have to interact with banks, then if you have a background of fintech, obviously your conversation will become that much more relevant. The outcome of the conversation would be very different from somebody who is naive about, you know, what fintech is all about, right? So you'll, I think it is definitely, I mean, you know, you can apply your learning depending on what your personal interests are, what under what context you are interacting, right? So, yeah, I don't think this learning will go, you know, useless in any context.
So Harish, next we may probably pick up a few questions from the chats. The first question for you is from Mr. Mahesh Sanghvi, who says that how is this course relevant for somebody in the corporate banking or wholesale lending space?
Yeah, I think good point. I don't think this course, at least when I did it, talked too much about corporate lending. It was more about retail, right? So, you know, I would put it this way, Mahesh. I think it is all about, you know, the course gives you the opportunity to bring your learning, let's say in the corporate side, which is not really digitized today. That is where the opportunity to digitize actually exists in the real banking world, right? So you should bring in some of the non-digitized use cases into the projects and try and see how you can solve it with, rather than you alone solving it, try and solve it with 5-10 people along with the professor guiding you, right? So use it as an opportunity to take back something into your industry and then probably, you know, apply it in your real world, right? So that's the way I look at it, because the course by itself is not guiding you to say, pick up a use case in corporate banking, right? It gives you a framework. It's up to you to bring your use case from your industry, apply it with your cohort and take some learnings back into the real world. Right? So that's the way I look at it. It won't teach you about corporate banking. You're an expert, I'm sure, being in that.
Harish, we have a question from Janendra. How much and what all fintech can disrupt in the lending domain in the financial services?
Oh, if you look at it, I think, you know, if payments was what was getting disrupted at least 2 to 3 years ago, every disruption that is happening today is about lending use cases, right? I'm sure you would have heard about things like buy now, pay later, you know, open credit enablement network happening in India, right? And then all the tons of fintech, lending apps, which have come in the country, which has become in a way a headache for RBI today in India context. And it was a big headache for, you know, Chinese banking regulators in the past, right? Everybody knows if you have to make money, you have to lend in banking, right? That's the essence of banking. Or you have to sell some products and make some commission out of it, right? There are only two ways, interest income or, you know, your fee income, right? These are the only two incomes that banking world is used to. And that is exactly the income lines for a fintech too. Right. So fee line, there is always a, you know, deficiency in terms of how much you can innovate, how much you can keep cross-selling. But obviously, if you can increase your lending pie and if you can be in more use cases for lending, obviously, you make more money. And that is where most of the fintech use cases are coming out today. Most of the fintech companies are innovating today and VC funding is also coming in today. So, yeah, lending is the next 2-3 years where, you know, a lot of money will. It's already flowing. It will continue to flow, I believe.
Next, Harish, we have a question from Mr. Mukesh. What kind of projects are typically taken up as a part of the program? And what kind of low-hanging fruits you see going forward in the fintech space? I mean, partially the first question is something that you've already taken up. But
I mean, you know, I think from a project perspective, you know, I mean, as I said, right, I think you need, the course gives you the freedom to go and pick up your subject, right? Some of them are, you know, mandated. So you'll have to definitely stick to what the course says. But majority of it, from what I recall, we had the flexibility to go and choose the, you know, project that we wanted to choose, right? So that's where, you know, the cohort, your own experience, right? You have a large team. You're part of a large team. So obviously, I don't think there'll be dearth of ideas. It's all about qualifying which idea you want to choose and then apply your, you know, minds together to complete that project across the different subjects that this course, you know, covers. And, you know, if you are really struggling to find a topic, obviously, I'm sure the professors are there to help and guide you, right? So that will be there, but I don't think you'll need to go there because the cohort is typically very wide with enough ideas. What is the second question? I forgot. What is the low-hanging fruit on fintech? Very difficult to say, right? I mean, it's a million-dollar question, right? If everybody knew, it was very easy to go and ask for that money from VCs and, you know, be in that space, right? But yeah, I think going back to the subject, you know, I think lending use cases, payment use cases, insurtech, you know, these are areas, you know, obviously RegTech, right? RegTech is a hot topic. These are the areas where, you know, we see a lot of use cases emerging. I wouldn't call any of them as low hanging because, you know, you have to still innovate within those to, you know, create your own differentiation, right? I don't know. I got your question right. I didn't understand exactly what you meant by what is low hanging in fintech, right?
So, Harish, we go to the next question from Mr. Sanjay. How this program can add value for career progression to those who are not having experience in the fintech domain?
Yeah, I mean, if you don't have experience, you have to start somewhere. And I would say this is a good start, right? You have got an IMC, certified program that you have gone through. Obviously, you have the experience of having done, I would say, at least 10, 15 projects in the fintech space, although more on the theoretical side, probably not on the practical side in terms of actually having developed something, right? But that's okay. I mean, you at least are confident enough after this course to say, I don't have the experience, but I have invested enough time to get myself trained and I'm out here in the market for opportunities, right? So you have to look at it that way, right? You have to make a start somewhere. Nobody's probably going to give you a fintech job. You'll be lucky if you get it. Definitely grab it. Or if you want to be a fintech yourself, you need some basic grounding, right? Look at this course and the experience that you gain out of it as a start. That's all I will say. It's a long journey then.
Next, we have a question from Deepesh Kumar. He says he's a banker working in a public sector bank with a background in the credit management of a large corporate. But fintech and blockchain, since it is the next big thing happening in the market, how is this program going to help him in his career progression in the credit domain? I do not have any technology background. Please, would you also be able to throw some light on the project programs that can be that are covered under this course?
I think I broadly address this, right? So it's very difficult to say that, how do you get some, if you are very keen to learn about your specific domain, right? Then do find out, courses which are out there and, in the market, which are very credit, focused, right? This is not by any means focused on credit alone, right? This is giving an overall flavor in fintech, overall flavor about blockchain, right? And then giving you the freedom to choose the projects that you want to bring into this course and learn from the professors, learn from the cohort, right? So, it is by no means a very, direct course about a particular subject, right? So, if it's, if I have to learn about, let's say, payments and, that too in retail payments or payments in corporate world, or if I have to learn about corporate credit underwriting, I wouldn't come for this course, right? That's not the intention. It is to broaden your horizon, get a much bigger flavor about what is happening in the fintech world. And then when you go back and do what you do in your, own, official life, some of this can be applied. That's all I will say, right? I mean, everything may not be relevant. Some of it can be applied, but vice versa, what you already know in your corporate world, you might be able to apply that in your projects in this course. That's all I will say. And get something out of it, right? To go back and probably reapply in your official life. So give and take, as I said, right? The more you give, you can take back something.
Right. Harish, we have another question from Mr. Manish Bose. He says he wants to understand how blockchain is particularly helping in the payment industry, like internet payment gateway and other payment domains like UPI and POS.
I mean, blockchain directly is not helping at this point of time when it comes to payments, because, if you really see, blockchain use cases are more about secure data sharing. So it is more being applied in the supply chain financing world. It's in the trade finance world, right, where you have multiple stakeholders, you need to traditionally exchange documents, right, in a physical form, or it used to take a lot of time. If there is a blockchain network which is being created, which, on which this data is being made available between these different stakeholders to do it faster, simpler, right, in a trustable way, that's where the blockchain use cases are actually evolved, right? In the payment space, for whatever reason, right, the blockchain use cases in the true sense, outside cryptocurrency, is yet to really evolve, right? There are CBDC, central bank digital currency, use cases happening between, corridors, not globally, between corridors, right? Between Saudi and UAE, between certain pockets, it is happening, right? But I think, as I said, blockchain, especially on the payment side, is for the future. So, maybe a UPI would probably, I'm just making it up, right? UPI could probably tomorrow transmit central bank digital currencies through those payment rails. Nothing stops them, right? But for that, central bank digital currencies need to be established first, for which RBI needs to take a decision whether it is going to be on a blockchain or not, right? We are in that evolutionary stage. If you start reading about it, if you don't know anything about blockchain, I think you will not read about it, right?
At least today I'm talking about it because I'm at least reading about it. Now tomorrow, practical use cases might come. I will get involved in them, right? So I think it has to evolve. Today, I don't see it happening around my life that actively. So for me, it is knowledge for the future, knowledge to keep myself updated, be relevant as and when it happens. I'll park it there, right? In terms of how I personally see it.
Harish, a very frequently or the most asked question in the chats is that I am a banker and I belong to a retail banking or maybe a traditional banking side of business and with around 10 to 12 years of experience. What kind of career opportunities can I look forward to after doing a program on fintech and blockchain?
I think you know, if you remain a traditional banker, sorry to say this, you know, I think your career path will come to an end, right? Because there's a limitation in terms of, you know, how much of a traditional banking will remain in the, you know, time to come, right? So you have to definitely evolve, you know, whether you're going to do something on your own, you're becoming a, you know, because fintech companies sometimes are run by very young professionals who probably do not have the banking experience, right? So you have to connect with them, right? You'll have to understand what they are trying to build and probably your knowledge is very, very useful for that team in terms of understanding, you know, the risk management in banking, right? They probably have zero understanding in that, right? Credit underwriting. Again, a very, very specialized banking subject, right? If a pure technology guy may not really have, you know, much appreciation about what happens in a risk underwriting process. You know, how do you look at the data? Yeah, how do you look at a document and interpret it and, you know, finally evolve it into, you know, score, right? So they will need people who understands pure banking, right? And similarly, a pure banker should understand them, for which that is essentially where you're bridging this gap, right? Courses like this gives you an opportunity to interact with them, with such people mutually, and, you know, try to learn from each other so that in the real world, you have a better appreciation of such conversations that will actually happen, right? So I'll put it that way. So, you know, don't shy away from, you know, transforming because there's an opportunity to transform. You will either transform by working with a fintech or being in courses like this where you get a chance to learn on the go because there are people from fintech who are going to interact with you, right? So it's an opportunity to transform.
Right. Harish, we have a question from Mr. Narendra Agarwal, who asks, will the course cover some basic understanding of technologies like AI, IoT, cloud, etc.? I mean, how technical would the course be? Do we need to be equipped with coding or how does it, what does the course exactly focus on?
Yeah, if it was to do with coding, I would not have joined, right? So that's the first thing. So this is a, you know, the way I see it, it's a course offered by a management institute. So it is in no way a technical, you know, course by any sense, at least this particular course, right? If you want to really learn about data analytics, probably AI, I'm sure there are courses out there, even IIM has it. I'm sure Talent Sprint has many. And, you know, there are different courses which will make you a technical expert in those specific domains, right? Here it is again more about the flavors. It's about the concepts. It's about applying it in a, you know, business scenario. What are the potential outcomes that such technologies can bring in a particular use case, in a particular industry? You get a flavor. It is no way a, you know, technical course. That's the way I would summarize it. Yeah, it's, you know, if you want to pursue technical courses in specific domains, this course would have given you some flavor. Or if you are purely a technical guy, I would say rather go for a course which will make you a specialist in that particular domain that you want to really make your hands dirty from a, you know, doing it perspective, right? Executing it perspective. That's a different course.
Harish, we also have a question from Sai Harsh, who says he's into funding of large corporate where the structure product as per clients required. How fintech is going to affect the large corporate funding?
Sorry, I'll have to say that, you know, this is not my area of expertise. So, you know, it would not be fair for me to comment in terms of how it will impact that particular domain. But all I can generalize is, you know, when you are an expert in that field, I'm sure, you know, the corporate funding, I'm assuming you're talking about syndicated funding, etc. And wherever, that's where I was going back to that basic criteria, right? If somebody asked me to go and innovate, create a fintech use case in this field, I'll talk to somebody like you to first understand what are the different processes that you run today to make your business happen. I will document the process. I will see where are the areas where there's a manual process still exists and see what kind of technology can be brought in those
manual processes to see, you know, whether there are wastages in the process, whether there are opportunities to digitize that process. I'll go step by step like this, right? And then look at what are the technologies. Maybe I'm not the right technologist. Go back to my technology colleagues to see what is the right technology that can digitize that use case, right? At scale, with enough security applied to it, so that that entire process actually becomes, I would say, digitized. And in the process, you call it a fintech-enabled process, right? It was earlier probably a lot of manual work. Today, how can I transform it into a digitalized process, right? So that's all I can generalize it. I wouldn't be able to comment specifically until I know what is that exact business process that you run today in terms of, you know, funding corporates as the final outcome.
Next, we have a question from Prabhas, who says, how well do you judge the world is moving towards cashless as well as cardless?
How well we are progressing, is it? As a country, is it? Is that
as a country? Yes, as a country, how well do you think we are progressing towards moving cashless and cardless?
I think we're progressing quite well in terms of, you know, percentage of cash transactions being converted into, you know, use cases being converted into digital transactions, for sure. But, you know, on the hindsight, because our GDP is growing, we are growing as a country, I think the cash economy is also growing, right? I mean, so it's not that, you know, the cash, the circulation of cash is coming down. It is in fact going up when I look at the statistics, right? But at the same time, the percentage of digitalization is also going up. So I think we are indeed positioned to go cashless as we go along. And an RBI is doing a lot of great things. They're coming up with, you know, new umbrella entities. I'm sure you heard about it in the news. They want more NPCIs to be in the country. The whole idea is, you know, how can you have 3 more UPIs, not just 1 UPI in the country, right? How can you enable more transactions, payment rails in the country, right? All these are to ensure that more and more use cases are getting digitalized in the country. More and more payments are going cashless. So sure, I think better than many other countries in the world, I think India is better positioned to go cashless. You know, obviously subject to, you know, we are operating at a very, very large scale as a country. So obviously, you know, the percentage growth will only happen over a period of time. But yeah, we are driving a huge growth. Thanks to the ecosystem, thanks to RBI, thanks to the targets that Government of India is setting banks every year, right? I think it is happening at a rapid pace, much, much rapid pace than many other country, keeping probably China as an exception, right? China is different because of whatever, you know, reasons under which they operate. But as a democratic country, I think you're doing great. A wonderful job.
Harish, that kind of gets me to my next question to you, which I was pretty much inquisitive to ask. I was, you know, reading an article which kind of mentioned that, you know, we look forward to no physical banking in the next, say, 5 to 7 years. There wouldn't be any banks with fintech being in picture. So is this true? I mean, do you really think that the changes that the fintech industry are getting into, the typical banking industry or banking sector, are so quick that we would probably not be able to see a typical bank in the next 5-10 years.
If somebody like, you know, if a country like Singapore tells me this, or if we are applying this to a Singapore, maybe 5 to 10 years, maybe the number of branches would be so, you know, so less that, you know, you can call it, there's no need of a physical bank anymore. But I think that is not the context in India, right? India, as we call it, Bharat, as we call it, the rural, as we call it, I think we are, you know, 10 years to me, at least. I'm no crystal ball, you know, gazing guy, but I feel practically looking at it, I think I don't see that, you know, tomorrow and State Bank of India or, you know, suddenly saying, you know, all my 45,000 branches have vanished. I don't see that happening.
Right. But is the change too quick? I mean, the way the fintech industry is evolving, or probably the way we are accepting the fintech space in India, is it pretty quick?
You know, different way to answer this is, you know, definitely there'll be a lot of, you know, branchless banks in operation, for sure. We'll have digital only banks, right? We'll have a good amount of the millennial population who would possibly ask all of us, you know, what is a branch, right? You know, we ourselves can kind of ask, right? When did we visit a branch? Probably maybe years together, right? Given the COVID world we are in, the last thing you want to do is visit a branch, right? So yeah, the branch is irrelevant, but maybe coming from the non-millennial, you know, the borderline, right? I would say, yeah, I have a comfort that there's a branch if there's an issue,
I know I can walk in, right? Today, for me, it's more about that. But maybe the business banking world, it's a different context, right? Maybe there are 10 reasons I would walk into a branch even today, right? Because the digitalization has not happened to that extent it should. But having said that, you're right. The pace at which it is happening is very, very fast. The banks will have to keep a balance between the number of branches that they need to keep open and they probably need to open in the future. And, you know, what exactly do you provide in a branch which you cannot provide in a digital context, right? It'll, you know, I think it has to evolve. There will be few things, I'm sure. Like, for example, you know, I'm taking a very, very traditional example, right? I mean, we all have lockers. I don't know how that will get digitized to an extent that you don't walk into a locker in the future. Right? If your digital asset itself become digitized, that's the extreme case scenario. But long way to go, right? Gold, which, you know, I'm sure all of us have in Indian households, will remain in a locker for some time to come. So I think branches will remain contextually for certain use cases. Definitely, I'm taking one, you know, probably an odd example, which I just quoted, but there will be many such examples for which you may still need a physical branch bank branch, right? Probably more of advisory services where you want to have a face-to-face meeting for whatsoever reason. Could be in the business context rather than in a consumer finance context. But otherwise, yeah, you know, the change is so fast that we will probably see, like, in the number of branches going down for sure, even in India. Yeah. May not be vanishing. Sorry, I think, you know, Sharda, I would also have to excuse myself. If we can kind of, you know, take one last question, so that would be helpful.
Yes, one last final question for you, Harish. This is a question from a participant who wants to know that he/she works out of a sales credit background. So do you think this course is useful for such people?
Sorry, from sales and credit background.
From a sales or a credit background.
Okay,
people sales belonging to a background. Sales or credit background, is it going to be a relevant course for them?
Yeah, I mean, you know, in many industries, you know, I mean, I would say, you know, the way digitalization will happen is if you are an excellent sales guy and if you understand the sales process. And similarly, if you're an excellent credit person and you understand credit processes so well, right? You are so relevant in terms of automating those processes for the respective banks or the fintech use cases, right? So it's all about translating the knowledge that you have in the physical world for a technology company or a technologist to convert it into a digitalized process. They will definitely rely on you, right? Yeah. If you are the best. And if you are equally fintech savvy, making yourself aware in terms of what are the possibilities in the fintech world, I think, yes, I mean, you will make a transition yourself, right? Because in many cases, probably the sales role is gone because the customer is doing self-service, right? You would expose a, you know, I'm just taking the context of the industry I am in, right? We have a merchant acquiring business. Earlier, there used to be a sales team which used to go and collect this, I would call the physical application, which used to travel into the physical offices, get scanned. Then the credit underwriting team looks at the physical document and the image and they do the underwriting, maybe in an Excel sheet, maybe in a tool, whatever. Today, we have got processes which got completely digitized, where the end merchant will fill up the application himself on his phone, on a mobile, you know, application. And he submits his documents, scans, uploads, no personal intervention. It comes to the credit underwriting team. And as long as we have got rule engines which are defined to underwrite this application, some of those applications can actually get underwritten, I would say 100% without a manual intervention. Right? This is because there was a brilliant credit underwriter who had the knowledge, was passed it on to the system and, you know, created a system which can do it autonomously. Right? So this is how the world is evolving. So if you remain a traditional salesperson or a traditional credit person, you will start losing relevance. So rather get updated, start applying your, you know, traditional knowledge into the new world and be part of the new world. Right? That's the way I see it. It's an evolution.
Of course. Thank you so much, Harish. I'm sure you were all the more patient in there and you've taken so many questions for us in this last 1 hour. The session was, of course, very insightful, and I'm sure we have been able to, you have been able to share your peace of mind in there in terms of your experience that you've had with the course and the benefits, of course, that you've landed up. So thank you so much for being around. Thank you.
My pleasure. I hope it was useful for all.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Arutro, if you can quickly launch the poll and quickly close up.
So I'll take your lead.
Yes, thank you so much, Harish. Thank you so much.